Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back from the break. We appreciate your coming back so promptly. Three quick announcements. First of all, some of you have your cell phones on. We heard them. We will find you. We will take it, and you will never see it again. Now, for me, yay! For me, that would be wonderful. I would just, you know, be real happy if somebody would take mine occasionally. So if you have one, please turn it to silent. Just before the lunch break, we will introduce the regional representatives. We're trying to get them all together in one place at one time and introduce them so that you know who they are. This next announcement, I'm only the messenger. I'm the moderator, so could I have the hard hat, the crown, the wizard, and everything? Lunch is not provided. You're on your own. So I know some of you were trying to buy my lunch ticket, but you can't have it. It's mine. So anyway, no, seriously, lunch is on your own. There's a Mexican restaurant that will have a buffet. There's the Common Ground, which is a deli. There's the Terrace Cafe. They are set up to get people in and out. You do not need reservations, even if you go in as a group of 500. So you don't need them. It's okay. If you decide, I've been asked, what about ordering room service? Don't go there. Don't go there. It's not that room service isn't good. It's that that will probably take you the longest of anything. So no, and ladies and gentlemen, you do not have time to go to the Galleria or North Park at lunchtime. So I think I've addressed everything that I was asked to do. I will tell you that right now, handwritten questions is someplace in the neighborhood of 200 questions. We encourage you to keep those questions coming. Having said that, I would like to turn it back to Pat, David, and John.
Thank you. I'd like to review a little bit of what we've done so far. The account manager has come to the RDS website, requested their plan sponsor account, requested their login ID. So meanwhile, behind the scenes, the RDS Center is validating that plan sponsor account information. We will then assign a plan sponsor ID and activate the account manager ID. The account manager will receive an email to let you know that you are invited to come back to the website. And where you will come is actually here back to our RDS public website and log in these boxes here. So you will recall that you created your own login ID and password, and that's what you'll use at this point in time. Fill in this information and click on the login button. What you'll see first is a home page for the account manager. And actually, this screen in the demo looks a little bit differently than it will look online. This home page depends on your role. So as an account manager, you will see this first box here for the account manager. If you were logging in as an authorized rep, you would see a very similar home page, actually. The actuary is only going to see information that pertain to the applications that they have been designated on for the attestation and information about the attestations that they need to complete. And the designee will, again, only see plan sponsor and application information related to the applications for which they have been designated. So back to the plan, back to the account manager homepage. You see here the plan sponsor ID. We've associated that with the name that you had entered when you set up the account, so you really don't have to get too concerned about remembering this ID number. Later on, we'll talk about your submission of your retiree list files, and you actually do not need to put the plan sponsor ID on those individual retiree records either, but we'll get there later on. So you see the name of your plan. you see the authorized representative. You see a status of your applications that are incomplete or pending. approved applications and rejected. Here we have Dave Gardner as an authorized rep with 5 rejected applications, so he hasn't done a very good job. But at any rate, we'll see if we can't educate him throughout this process.
Because I don't have my wizard hat on.
Right. Okay,
back to account manager.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, you know, you're still account manager.
Sorry, we're there.
Okay. From this, let's see, what else do I want to tell you here? Oh, I'd also like to point out on the right-hand side the various account settings or things that you can do from your home page. You can create another new plan sponsor account as an account manager. You can be the account manager for multiple plan sponsor accounts. You can start your application from here. Manage your retiree list. This probably will simply be changing the methodology that you wish to submit your file on. Manage your own personal information. If your email address changes or something like that, you can go there and change that information. Change your plan sponsor information and your password. I also want to point out that there will be bulletins displayed here that will alert you to different things related to the application process. As I said before, we are in a rapid development mode, so we're rolling out this application in phases. And if we need to notify you about a certain functionality that won't be available August 1, but will be available September 1, this is where you would find that information, as well as on the public website. Okay. So I am actually going to start an application finally, and by clicking on this link, start a new application. Again, what I need to do here is pick one of my plan sponsors that I have set up, and then I create whatever name for this particular plan or this application means something to me. So this is a user-defined plan name. That's what you'll see then back on, I should have mentioned, let me go back to this home page here. If you have obviously not started any applications, you would just see dashes all the way across, and you might only see one plan sponsor ID. So as you work with the system, this page will fill up with more information. So let me then go back. Okay, so I'm at starting an application. You fill out this information, your plan start date and your plan end date. It's important that the application has only one start date and end date. So if you have multiple benefit options that have different start and end dates, you need to fill out a separate application for those. So that's one factor, one reason why you might have to complete several applications if you have different benefit year dates. I'd also like to show you, over here we'll have information on quick help for this particular page. There'll also be a home and help up here, but I thought that I would show you that you can get a quick description about the fields on the screen that you're working on, just a little bit of extra help if you have any questions there. So I would fill out this information and click on the continue button. It's also important to note, since we're all in a mad dash to get our applications in by September 30th, this is the point at which you need to arrive in order to request an extension. So you must have set up your account manager, login ID and plan sponsor account, receive notification via email, again that takes 1 to 2 business days, and then come back to the website, start your application, click on continue, and at that point you would be able to actually perform the function of requesting an extension. So
again, the important message there is make sure you give yourself a few days leeway before that deadline approaches so that you can get all the information you need into the system.
Yeah, I'd highly recommend that you start this process right away. You can see that you don't really need that much information to get to this point. And then we'll save this information for you. You can come back when you're ready with the rest of the information to fill out your application. Okay. Clicking on continue has brought me back to this plan sponsor application list. You'll actually find that you'll use this page frequently. It shows you the by plan sponsor ID. It shows the application numbers or the applications that you have currently set up, whether they're incomplete or in process. pending, meaning that you have submitted that to the RDS Center for validation, but we have not yet approved it. You'll also see a status here of approved, and in the event that your application does not meet all the criteria necessary, you'll see it displayed here as in a rejected status. There'll also be other links here related to, you know, to give you other information about whether the attestation has been done or not. Your actuary is coming to the site independently, and you'll obviously need to check with them on a regular basis over the phone or via email yourself to make sure that they perform this function, but you can also come back here and check for yourself. We have our plan start date and plan end date for the application. And then depending on the status of your application, various actions over here that you would select in a drop-down box. So you see here, view would be, when I go into view this incomplete application, that is essentially I'm going to work, not only view the application, but essentially work on it and complete the rest of the information. Requesting an extension, this is where, again, you would actually go to perform that function. I'll discuss that a little bit more later. And if you've decided that you started this application and are not going to complete it, you can delete it from here as well. For a pending application, you may have decided that you supplied some incorrect information and you want to withdraw that application before the RDS Center has actually gone and approved it or rejected it. And this is where you would perform that function. Let's see, if you have a rejected application, this is also where you would perform the process to appeal that rejection and submit that to the RDS Center. We'll talk a little bit more about that later as well.
Right, and we'll be touching on appeals tomorrow.
Okay. So I'm actually going to go in and work on this first application. This, again, the data on the screen is just made up for demonstration purposes. Really, we were developing these screens as we sat in our design sessions. But you'll see here at the top where I would be able to change from this screen to a different application if I chose to do so. Then you see a summary box here with your plan sponsor ID, the plan sponsor name and description, the name of the authorized representative, name of your account manager, the application number, plan description, and the plan start and end dates. We also give you some information here about when the application was started, and if it was submitted, you would see the date of submission. And if RDS had already made a decision, you would see whether this application had been approved or rejected. I should note, this is another page that you'll spend a lot of time on. Each application section is listed here. It fairly well corresponds to the application sections that Jim discussed earlier. But in some cases, we have some minor modifications just to make the system a little bit easier to maneuver. You will see a green check mark on the side here if that portion of your application has been completed satisfactorily. A dash if it has not yet been completed. And you may see this exclamation mark if there's actually an error on that part. So you can come here and view if your application was rejected due to some errors on it that we had found in the validation process. You can come here and see that what section of the application. Also, at the top of the screen here, it's not in this demo, we will have a button here for an error report. So if your application has been rejected, you would come here to this application status page and click on the error report, be able to view that from here, and also print that off if you wanted to take it and work with it outside of the system.
So I guess it's also important to explain the status column, because it is conceivable that if you look at the benefit option line, that you could have more than one benefit option involved with your application. So over here we are enumerating the number of options you have. So if you've completed one and it's meted the acceptable criteria, it's passed some of our online edits, this will have a green check mark, correct? So
yes.
So that doesn't necessarily mean that you are finished with that section. It just means that everything that's been submitted in that area of the application checks out. You can go back and add more at a later time.
Okay, let's see. Also, if the RDS center has not, if you have not submitted your application and the RDS center has not made a decision on your application, you will not see this post-approval column that only displays on a completed and either accepted or rejected application. And you would then use that column in order to navigate through the application subsequently. There's also corresponding links. So you see down here the various sections of your application. Those same sections are over here on the right-hand side. You can navigate either way, but I'm probably going to stick to using these links over here. So I'm going in to assign designees. Again, this is an optional feature, but if I, as account manager, and actually at this point in time, it's important to note that the authorized rep could have started the application. We're assuming that 99% of the time it'll be your account manager. And either the authorized representative or the account manager can assign designees. You will go in, and this screen should look a little bit familiar. When we were back naming the authorized rep, we asked that you put in the email address first to find out whether we knew this person or not. And this page works essentially the same way, where you would put in the email address for your designee. We would do a search for you to find out whether we know this person or not. If we got a hit, we would show you the name. Is Joe Smith, in this example, actually the designee that you intended? If so, you can click on the accept button and move on. Otherwise, you would either modify your search or click on the add new, which is what I'm actually going to do here. So then clicking on the add new would display this information here where you see the required fields of the full name, the email address, and there's also one other piece of information that we ask for security purposes for these designees, and that's a passphrase. This is a phrase that you make up yourself. It actually could be one word. There aren't any real stringent edits on it. But the purpose of that is for you to, as the account manager, provide this passphrase to your designees outside of RDS. Off-band, it's referred to. And our security analysts like the idea of making sure that that there is that connection between the account manager and designees. So the account manager would make up the passphrase and then provide that passphrase outside of the RDS system to their designee. The designee will need it when they return back, and it's just an added security check. You'll see here also checkboxes down at the bottom of the page. Regardless of whether we know this designee or not at RDS, regardless of whether they already have obtained their login ID or not, you must list off on this particular application what the designee is allowed to do. So, as I mentioned before, a user can play only one role on the website, so a designee, once named as a designee, can only function as a designee. However, from application to application, their permissions, so to speak, what they're allowed to do on a particular application can change. So you would enter their full name, their email address, the passphrase, and re-enter the passphrase for accuracy, and then click off what actual permissions that you would like to grant to this designee. Clicking on continue will take you back to the application status page. And I'm actually, Dave's probably tired of wearing his construction hat, so you can put your designee cowboy hat back on.
Alrighty then.
Yeehaw. And we'll get into some of the functions that a designee could perform if I had given them these rights. Now, I have to jump down. This is where my demo gets just a little bit clumsy, so bear with me. But I have to jump down here and show you the actual page that would be presented to the designee. Maybe. There we go. We will send an email to your designee inviting them with a one-time link to come to the website. They'll follow that link. They will not go to the home page for the public website, but rather follow that link in their email to this designee registration page. So on this page, it'll give them information about the plan sponsor that they've been designated for and the application. They also ask them to enter the passphrase here on the screen right away. So you would put in that passphrase, and then you would also read and sign your user agreement. Again, every user of the website is asked to read through this user agreement, click on this box here and as acceptance, and click on continue. Now, some of these screens should start again to, or should continue to look familiar. Again, notice the navigation on the side where it's guiding the user through the process, the various steps that will take place. And then also, step by step, here's personal information that we're asking for the designee. First name, social security number, date of birth, their job title, telephone, and mailing address. That information would be filled out, and again, the asterisks indicate what are the required fields. And click on continue. And you're brought to the login information page where the designee then would make up his login ID and password and also select the security questions. Sorry. Okay. I'll kind of spin through this. This page isn't completely filled out, but once again, after you've completed that information, you'll be shown the designee summary page, be asked to review your information. If everything looks great, then you submit that, and you'll receive a thank you page. So you have not yet received your activated login ID. You've made it up. Now the RDS Center, just like with the account manager, needs to, behind the scenes, validate your information and activate your login ID. You'll receive an email in 1 to 2 days letting you know, as a designee, that you have your login ID has been activated. If you already have a login ID, suppose that you're a designee on another application for another plan sponsor, the email that you'll receive when you're named or designated on the application will be different. Instead of sending you a link, a one-time link saying, please come and register on the website, the email will actually have verbiage more along the lines of, you've been designated for an application, please, you know, come and log on, and you would just go to the public website, log on, and view your home page to see what applications you've been designated on. So it's, you'll only go through this process one time. Okay, as I said, you would come back to, I'm a little bit behind here. You'd come back to the public website, enter your login ID information and password, and click on the login button, where you would then see your home page would be somewhat limited here. As a designee, it's not your responsibility to submit and track the status of the application, but rather just to fill out the components of that application that you are allowed to fill out. So you would first click on the plan sponsor ID that you're going to work with, and that same plan sponsor application list would show. As a designee, only the applications that you are responsible for or designated on would display here. If the plan sponsor has other applications for which you were not designated, they would not display on this page for you. At this point, I'm going into back to this familiar screen, my application status screen. And I could be, again, the designee, or I could be the account manager at this point in time. It's your choice what hat you want to wear, Dave. And I'm going to go in now and add my benefit options. So I'm clicking on this section here. The first page you get, oh, there we go. The first page you get is a summary page of the benefit options that you might have added already, and the status of them. You see here that there'll be a status of the attestation, whether the actuary has been in and performed the attestation there for that particular benefit option. You'll also note whether or see whether you have completed the section to assign your benefit option administrator or not. I'm going to click on add a benefit option and fill out this information. On this page, you make up your own benefit option name, whatever is meaningful to you for this particular option under your plan. Usually they do have some sort of name like the platinum, gold, silver plans or something along those lines. You may have various options that are based on the year that someone retired, different options granted year by year or a range of years. You could actually use a retirement date as a, if that's helpful for you, but it really is defined. It's a required field, but it is defined by you. The unique benefit option identifier is also a required field. This, however, in most cases, we would expect you to use your prescription drug group number, the group number that is on printed on the prescription drug insurance cards for your retirees. If you don't use a group number for some reason, or you use the same group number for multiple benefit options, you need to create a unique identifier. So if you're in the case of using multiple or using the group number for multiple benefit options, you could use the group number and append an A, B, and C at the end, whatever again is most meaningful to you. It's important though that you've set up this group number. The application ID and the group number here, or the unique, what we're referring to as the unique benefit option identifier, those are required fields on each record of your retiree file. So, and must correspond. So in order for us to match up the retiree file that you'll send us, we need those records on that file to contain the application ID and the unique benefit option that the retiree belongs to.
And again, we've given flexibility here. You can create and you know, treat this number, the unique benefit option identifier, in a way that is meaningful to you. This is something that we changed. In the original application that was out for public comment, we were sticking to RX group number. And based on a lot of feedback we got about the use of that RX group number, we did make this a more flexible thing. But that said, it's very, very important because it links our system behind the scenes so that we can track which retirees are in the various options throughout the course of the plan benefit year, because retirees can be mobile, they can change. So with that, that feeds into the final, and we'll talk about reconciliation a little bit more tomorrow, but with the files that come in, your update files, we keep track of those adds, updates to those retiree information, and that number is just extremely critical to making it all work out in the end for payment purposes.
One field I didn't mention here, we do ask that you indicate whether the option is self-funded or fully insured, again, for our statistical tracking purposes. Click on continue, and that brings you to the benefit option administrator page, where we're asking you to fill out the company name and the business address for your benefit option administrator. We also ask that you complete information for the benefit option administrator contact. Later on, this person may be an actual user of the website for the purposes of this initial rollout until we get to the payment process. We're not actually creating a user role for the benefit option administrator. We're still debating a little bit. We think that the benefit option administrator, someone who might need to help you submit payment information, might just be another designee on your application. But at any rate, we do ask for a contact information here. You'll see a similar process before enter the email address. Let us find out whether we know this person yet or not. If we don't know them, you would add a new person, full name, the telephone, email address. there's a little bit of help here to, you know, fill out some information automatically from previously entered information.
And just to clarify a little bit, if you have a benefit option administrator that you know is going to be extremely important to your ability to submit an accurate application, and you have an individual there that you know needs to participate, you can certainly make them a designee. At this point, we're sort of using two different labels, but as Pat alluded to, at a later point, benefit option administrators in our system may be consolidated to just be another type of designee, and that's something we're working on right now.
Okay, so I've completed adding that benefit option, and again, the others that you're including on this application as part of your plan, you would continue through that process for as many benefit options you wanted to include in your application, I guess that's what I'm trying to say. You'll go back to your application status screen, again, that familiar screen that's showing you how far along you've gotten in the process as we're checking off. I'm now going to go in and assign my actuaries. On this screen, we've added a lot of flexibility. And I need to explain that the screen won't actually appear exactly as you see it here today, but it'll follow a similar process. First, you will answer this question about are you actually combining two or more benefit options for the purpose of demonstrating that the plan meets the actuarial equivalence net test. Depending on your answer to that, that's what dictates what then will display on the screen, because depending on your answer, we need attestations at different levels. If you're combining several plans, then you'll need to have an actuary attest to the gross test on each benefit option, and then an overall net test for the combination. On the other hand, if you're not combining, then the actuary would be requested to attest to the gross and net test of actuarial equivalence by benefit option. So this is very important when you set up this screen, because it's also going to dictate what's shown to your actuary when they come, or actuaries, when they come to the website to perform the attestation. So you want to make sure that prior to completing this page, you have figured out how you're combining options or not. So you can see here where I am, you know, again, depending on how I click on this process, or on how I answer this question, it depends on how what's going to display. Let's say that I'm not combining options, and I will see my benefit options displayed here separately for the gross and net value test for each. On the other hand, well, let me go up here and click on one for that is not assigned and show you how you actually add an actuary. So you'll have these prompts all throughout these screens. Here, again, very similar to other screens where you've designated different users of your application. Enter the email address of your actuary. So you're going to have to be in touch with your actuary prior to completing your application. First, we want to find out whether this actuary has already authenticated or received a logon ID to the RDS secure website. And if not, you would click on Add New and come down and fill in familiar-looking information. The only new piece of information here is the American Academy of Actuaries membership ID number. That number, as the designee or account manager who is naming this actuary, you need to obtain this number from your actuary. Our friends at the Academy are being great in terms of helping us roll out this program to their actuaries and provide membership numbers. They actually do issue membership numbers, and they might show up on the invoice for dues, but it's not a number that the actuary is used to using and carrying around on a card or something like that. But we needed some sort of identifier to validate that they were indeed a member of the American Academy of Actuaries. So they are implementing on their website a new feature where an actuary can go to the AAA website and opt into the program. Now, this is not linked to RDS, but they're doing a whole campaign, outreach campaign to inform their members about the process. So an actuary would go there, opt in, and be provided. They already have user IDs and passwords for their own website. They would then be provided with their membership number. They would then and give this membership number to their account manager.
And I think, I hope I'm right, but I think the website is www.actuary.org. Pretty sure that's right.
Yeah, we might have to look that up later. That sounds very familiar. I have been out there. It's a very nice website. Like I said, the Academy only wants to share, though, data of their members with RDS for those members who have actually opted in. So it's important to work with your actuary, make sure if they're going to participate in this program that they go out there and they opt in on the Academy's website. So you've completed this information. It brings me back to assigning my actuaries and finishing that process. Let's see, what else? Going back now to my application status screen. I'm kind of just going down through the list here. I'm going to skip over the attestation for a few minutes and look at the electronic funds transfer info. This one's a little simpler to figure out or to complete. Required information includes your bank name, obviously, the account type, checking or savings, the company name associated with the account. And again, that's for matching purposes in our communication with our bank and performing the tests of the electronic fund transfer, the EFT process. Your account number, re-entering your account number to hopefully prevent any typographical errors. The bank routing number as well. And then a contact name for the bank. This is someone who works for the bank who, if we have some trouble with our, we're going to perform what's called a pre-note test. In this initial application process, obviously no monies will be exchanged until after January, but we will test the transaction and make sure that your bank account and make sure that we can communicate between RDS and your bank. And if we have any trouble, we'd like a contact name of someone that can help us work through those technical difficulties. Then we also ask for the bank address. And click on continue, and that's all there is to it for the EFT information.
I guess we really should have my partner in crime over here back down on his hat duty. So I guess it's important to know that both people can keep doing this. Think I can sit here for very long? How long do you think I could do this?
I don't know.
Okay, that's rough crowd. Okay.
I don't know what he's doing either, actually. Yeah. So.
Well, you could put it on.
We didn't practice that part. All right, fine. Well, he'll mess up my hair, but it was going to happen eventually, right?
Yes.
Okay. Payment frequency is the next page or part of the application that I'm going to go in and fill out. This is my favorite one because really all I have to do is select that I will opt in, send my monthly my payment requests on a monthly, quarterly, interim, annual, or annual basis. Click on one radio button of your choice and continue.
She looks better in the hat.
The retiree list submission method is the next section that I'm going to fill out on the application. This is not actually transferring my file yet, but telling the RDS Center how you intend to transfer your file. As most of you should know by now, there are three different methods. Again, maximum flexibility. We're trying to make it as simple as possible to submit these files to the RDS Center. Let's see. The way that the screen will work is first you'll be asked to select your submission method, and then different information will display, or you'll be asked for different information depending on the method that you select. Let's see. I thought at this point we also might talk about how you would decide what method you're going to use. We have the upload the file via the secure website. In an earlier presentation, we said that that was going to be secure FTP. That's actually not completely accurate. It is an HTTPS file transfer protocol that we're using instead. But for the average user and not the technical person, you know, you don't have to worry about that, but I want it to be completely accurate here. And it is very secure, and actually we're using this methodology because it's easier for the end user, and I'll talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, a couple of the other options we were considering early on would have required plan sponsors to actually purchase some software. It wouldn't have been very expensive, but we thought that, again, going back to easy, simple, flexible, we wanted to make sure that there weren't anything hindering your interest in participating in the program. So we, again, took that off and went with this other technical option that doesn't require you to do anything except open up your browser, sign on to the website, and navigate to the appropriate page.
Okay, so you may select upload to the secure website if you're a small to mid-size plan sponsor. A large plan sponsor could use this option as well.
Okay, we will be able to handle the large file size on
your
website.
You'll see later, though, that you may find that it just takes a little bit longer. You have to, you know, have obviously patience. They're pretty small records, small files. It's not a lot of data on your retiree files. So we can, even if you are a larger plan sponsor, we can accept your file this way. But originally, we were thinking that it would be the small to mid-sized plan sponsors utilizing that option. The next option is sending your file mainframe to mainframe via AGNS or the AT&T Global Network Services Network. This is a closed, secure network that CMS utilizes frequently. It utilizes it for the VDSA process. I refer to AGNS as Agnes, so I might as well just tell you that now. If you have an Agnes account already, we'd be able to get you set up pretty readily to be able to transmit your files across the Agnes network to the mainframe that we're using for the RDS center. You may choose this method because your system, your retiree information resides on a mainframe, and it's just easier for you to automate the process this way. And again, larger plan sponsors is what would most likely typically pick this option. And then the third option that John Albert is going to provide a lot more information on is the COB Voluntary Data Sharing Agreement, or VDSA. That, as John will explain, is there certain advantage, certain additional information that you can obtain as a plan sponsor about Medicare entitlement if you agree to work with COB and send in other data that they may be interested in. So if I selected on the secure file upload, you're not required to do anything else. Once you select that option, we're going to create in our file transfer facility a mailbox for you for the application. Multiple users can be assigned to that application. So we're assuming that the authorized rep, the account manager, will have access to that mailbox, as well as anyone that you designated on your application as someone who would perform this function of uploading and downloading your retiree files and the responses we send back. So at this point, you could click here to actually go ahead and upload your file, or you could do that at a later date. If you had selected the mainframe to mainframe via Agnes, we're going to ask you for some technical contact information. that's necessary for us to, you know, there's some intervention that needs to be done to set up the file names and transfer of that and testing of that connectivity. So you would fill out this information and then be contacted by RDS Center staff who specialize in this sort of connectivity and file exchange, and they would work with your technical contact to get it set up and running. On the other hand, if you select the COB Voluntary Data Sharing Agreement, you actually need to contact the Coordination of Benefits contractor, and John will explain how that process works. Another factor here in terms of deciding what to select for your retiree list file submission method is timing. When are you going to be able to get this process up and running to submit your file? You've got to meet your filing deadline. So if you need to submit your file by September 30th, please make sure that you select a file transfer method that you can actually meet that deadline with. You can come back after you submitted your application and change your file transfer method. So if you are working on a VDSA agreement right now, let's say, and your testing gets slowed down, you're having maybe a technical difficulty or something, you can come back to your application, change your submission method selected to, say, upload to the website, and do that until you get VDSA in place. So we're, again, trying to be flexible there. Okay. At this point, I'm going to show what it's going to look like when the actuary comes to register. So I'm going to jump down, and you get to wear the wizard hat, all right. I'm going to jump down to the actuary registration page. Again, after you've designated or named your actuary, they will receive an email and be invited to come to the website. They'll follow this secure link to this one-time link to this registration page. First thing that they'll be asked is to enter their American Academy of Actuaries number. And then they'll be asked again to sign the user agreement and will request some personal information. We will not request the Social Security number for the actuary. It's not needed at this time for authentication since we're using that American Academy of Actuaries number. But we do ask for some contact information here. Fill out that information. And again, this is all looking very familiar at this point. They'll fill out their personal information and then be asked to create their login ID and password, and then select their security question and type in their answer for that. They will be asked this security question again when they come back to attest, and every time they're asked to attest, they need to submit this answer to the answers to both of these security questions in order to complete that attestation.
And for those of you that just woke up, when you get the DVD of the conference, you can just hit rewind, go back, and you'll see earlier on what we're talking about in terms of login IDs.
What did I do?
No, I was just saying, looking out at the audience, and this is getting pretty technical.
Oh, I'm sorry. Am I boring
pretty,
you?
I mean, the hats are starting to be old news, you know?
I know. I told you I was getting down into the weeds, and
we're
I should have saved the hats for later.
We're
but
in the weeds.
Okay, the actuary.
Stay with us, people. Stay with us.
Actuary will receive a summary page. They'll submit that information. Now, what's different here is the actuary will actually be validated or authenticated right there online. They don't have to wait 1 or 2 days for us to go behind the scenes. Because, again, we have a data sharing agreement with the American Academy of Actuaries, we're able to validate that actuary's membership number right there on the fly. And they will actually be able to log into the system and come here to their homepage. Again, their homepage will show the plan sponsors and applications for which they've been assigned. So I'm going to click on this plan sponsor ID. And you'll see a familiar page here again for the plan sponsor ID and the list of applications. And again, the actuary will only see those that they have been assigned. On this page, you'll see that we actually will let them know what has not been attested to yet so that they can click on that link and go to an attestation page. This page will display depending on how you set up your benefit options, as I said earlier. So if the actuary is named to attest just to the gross value of a benefit option, that's all that will display for them, and they can click on this attest now. If, on the other hand, they're attesting to the overall net value, they would see that section display here and be able to attest to that from here. On the other hand, if you're not combining options, then they would be asked to attest to both the gross and net value test by benefit options. So you have the flexibility here to use one actuary, several actuaries. It really just depends on your own configuration, how you're setting up your application. So just to show you what this page looks like, again, this page will depend on the nature of what you're attesting to, whether it's the gross value test, whether it is the net value test, or a combined gross and net value test. We ask that the actuary read this information. They'll click here, and then to complete their what we're referring to as their electronic signature, they'll be prompted with their security questions and have to submit their answers. So they'll submit those answers and click on the continue button, and that takes them back to essentially their summary page. It's all that the actuary can do. I wanted to note a couple of other things. There's no actual attachment, and some of the language and instructions on how to complete your application, it says that you will attach your attestation. What you just saw is all that the actuary will be required to submit on the website. Obviously, they and the plan sponsor need to retain their worksheets that justify the actuarial equivalents. But those are maintained, those worksheets are maintained and stored outside of RDS. It is not the RDS center's responsibility for saving that information. That would be ultimately the plan sponsor and authorized rep's responsibility to make sure that information is retained. Okay, back to the hard hat.
Is it just the hard hat, or can a designee be doing what we're about ready to do?
No, actually, it's just the hard hat.
Okay,
so
you get a reprieve here from the hat usage.
Now I have hat head, but okay, I'm going to jump back to my application status page here. So as the account manager, who is, again, controlling this whole application process, we're expecting you to come back to this application status page and take a look at the application summary. You'll see check marks here that, you know, the various sections of the application have been completed. And again, this is just a demo, so don't give me a hard time that not all my sections are checked. You'll click on the application summary page, and this is a convenient place for you to go as the account manager and also as the authorized rep, actually, to be able to view the information that's been put in and see the status of your application. You can look at this summary at any time while you're completing the application, but it's the place that you would go at the end in order to notify that the authorized rep that the application is ready to be submitted. You'll recall that the account manager can't sign the plan sponsor agreement and can't actually submit the application. So they can get it all done, and at this point, they would click on the notify button here at the bottom in order to notify the authorized rep via email that their application is ready to be submitted. I also, while I'm here on the screen, I thought I would show you our contact page. If this is a different contact function or feature than what you see on our public website, this contact page is only for authenticated or logged on users of this secure website. And so if you have a particular question that you want to get answered by the RDS Center, you could come here, put in your name and email address will help us identify you and respond back to you. That's important. You can select a topic and then a free form area here to answer or to ask your questions. Submit that and be able to, you know, then get an email reply from the RDS Center customer service reps. So I'm back here on my summary page. I'm going to click on notify because I do think that I'm ready to notify the authorized rep. At this point, we're going to go through the steps that the authorized representative then would have to perform. So back to, if we have the other crown, actually, we could get the other crown.
Do you
want
to break the other one out?
Okay. Sure, why not?
I think they're ready for it. Looking at the audience, they're ready. I'm not sure I'm ready for it. Love this hat.
I couldn't decide. It reminds me of, for those who remember, the Imperial Margarine commercials.
I'm getting more powerful.
Dun ta da da. Okay, so I'm going back to,
I feel
again,
like I should be baking bread or something.
The authorized rep received an email invite to come and register. Again, it's going to look very familiar, really. The only difference here is that they're clicking on and validating their account manager. As we said before, the account manager is off and running. They have been authenticated. They've started the application. This is really the latest point in time that the authorized representative can come to the website and start interacting. I would actually highly suggest that the authorized representative come and register and get his or her logon ID sooner than this, because there is a certain timing issue. In order to meet your timely filing requirement, the authorized rep has to submit that application, and they won't be able to submit it without a login ID. And you're pretty familiar with the process now, that you'll enter all this personal information and then wait a couple of days and be notified via email that your ID has been activated. So sign the user agreement and continue. Again, personal information, full name, security, social security number, date of birth, job title, telephone, and business address. Continuing through the process, again, the login ID and the security questions. And one more time, security questions for the authorized rep are important to remember the answers to those, because it's part of your electronic signature when you go to sign the plan sponsor agreement. So you'll complete that information and click on continue. The authorized representative will again get a summary, be able to change any of that information that they've just submitted. And otherwise, if everything looks good, they'll submit it. They'll get their thank you page with next step instructions. They'll receive that email telling them to come out to the telling them that their login ID has been activated, and come to the RDS public homepage in order to sign in. So come here, fill out your login ID and password information, click on login. The authorized representative will receive a homepage that looks very much like the account manager's. I'm interested in going into and submitting an application that I've been notified is ready for submission. So by coming again to the plan sponsor application list, selecting view, clicking on go, and I'm back to this familiar page, this time though as the authorized rep. The plan sponsor agreement is the last option down here. I would actually suggest that the authorized rep go to that application summary page first. It's just a convenient place to see all the information that's been submitted. They do need to attest to the accuracy of this information. They could, on the other hand, go in page by page and look at each detail page if they so desire as well.
And I guess at this point, if they were ready to submit, they would have the green checks down the left side instead of the other.
Absolutely. Oh, it's also important to note that in order to submit your application on the secure website, you do not have to have already submitted your retiree list. Because of the various people that might be uploading the file or transferring it mainframe to mainframe or interacting with the COB contractor, we realize that it might be out of the control of the account manager or the authorized rep to actually get this file transferred. So you are able to submit, the authorized rep is able to submit the application prior to the retiree list being received at the RDS center. Now, of course, we won't approve and, you know, completely validate your application without that retiree file. We'll basically take it, validate it as far as we can, and hold it until we receive the retiree list and finish the validation process.
And the RDS Center must receive that retiree list again by that cutoff date of September 30, or whatever your extension date is, 30 days later. So everything has to be in on time, and then we'll process it.
Okay, so as the authorized rep, we are clicking on the plan sponsor agreement page, and we need to read and sign away our firstborn. No, I'm just kidding. read this information. I'm obviously not going to go through it. It does look a little scary at the moment, but I'm sure you're all mostly familiar with that. And then here is where you'll be prompted with your security questions and have to submit your answers to those. Clicking on here to approve after, along with those answers, is then completes the process for that application submission, and you're taken back actually to your homepage if, in case there's another application that you would like to go and work on and submit. I think at this point it's a good breaking spot, and. Well, I can talk to those guys later. Go ahead.
Okay, now remember, I'm the messenger, and I want David and John to come up here and protect me, and I want the hard hat, because I have an announcement to make, and some of you are not going to be happy, so I'd rather just tell you that right up front. But then we're going to end on a positive note before we go to lunch, and I'm going to introduce you to your regional people. How many of you, by show of hands, have been successfully able to access through wireless in this room? Show of hands. Thank you. How many have been unsuccessful in their attempt to access through the wireless? Okay. How many of you wish that you could access through the wireless, but there is not enough tea or coffee with caffeine in it to get you through it? Here is the problem, and we have been, and I apologize to our panel if it was all disruptive. We have been problem solving a situation that has arisen. And let me just very quickly explain it to you techies out there in the language that they're explaining to me, who is not a techie. In this room, you have access with your computer. If you have the wireless card, you should be able to get, as I indicated earlier this morning, immediate access. That is for the confines of this room only. If you step outside of this room, you are no longer on what we are calling the universal access. So, if you want access outside of this room, it will cost you $12.95 for 24 hours. You purchase it at the front desk, and it is your expense. We do not cover the expense. At this point in time, the programming is different. So if you purchase that $12.95 24-hour access, they do not believe that it will work inside this room. See, I told you you weren't going to be happy.
How would you like your hat?
I want my own hard hat. It's got earmuffs on it.
I do have an extra.
In my real life, I do OSHA training. So, now, if you've been trying to access the wireless inside this room and you have been unsuccessful, the hotel IT person will be here at 12 o'clock to work with any of you that are having trouble accessing in this room only. So if you are one of those individuals, please stick around. And I believe his name is Chris. I think that's what they've told me. Now, the other thing is that if you have tried to access the high-speed internet in your rooms and you have not gone into Wyndham by request and you are paying a fee to access the high-speed internet, would you please give me your name and your room number? Because if you go into Wyndham by request, you should be able to access the high-speed internet at no fee. Tomorrow I'm going to wear shoulder pads.
Too many choices.
Oh no, it gets better. It does get better. If you went over to the Veranda Club to work out and they were not aware that you were supposed to get comped, then what you need to do is go back. There is a registration form there. And you will need to show your badge and sign up. If you went over and you used the Veranda Club and they charged you for a daily pass, again, give me your name and your room number and tell me that you've been charged in the Veranda Club. That is only for the fitness center. That does not include massages
or any of those other things, which I will tell you, I will be over there. Now, there are, okay, now, don't all get up at once, approximately 200 hard copies, as I indicated this morning, of the handouts. They are located at the information booth between the elephants. You gotta love it. Just gotta love it. So, though that's all the challenging news that I have for you. But if you are one of those people that needs help with your wireless, if you have had things that you've gotten at the Veranda Club or high-speed internet charged for, please make sure that you give me your name up here, and we will do what we can to help that. Now, if you got charged for anything else, like your mini bar, that don't give me that. I don't want that information. That's too much information. So now, before we break for lunch, I would like to have the regional people, as I call your name, please stand up so that everybody else knows who you are. Judy Flynn and Jennifer Magyar, I hope I pronounced that right, from the Kansas City office. Kelly Singleton from the New York regional office. Barbara Manning from the Boston regional office. Alan Conroy from the Dallas regional office. Ralph Sloan from Atlanta. Mara Seiler Price from Chicago. Mara, are you here? Okay. Diane Tickle from the San Francisco regional office. Where are you, Diane? I don't know where she is. Okay. Over where? Where are you, Diane? Stand up, Diane. There she is. Okay. That's a nice little jig you do over there. And Rod Hayes from Seattle. Rod, are you here? Well, Rod is already trying to get his high-speed internet. So there you go. Having said that, if you have any of these forms, you see our facilitators, if you've got your question forms filled out, give them to one of the facilitators, put them in the registration desk, and you are adjourned until 1:30 this afternoon. Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back from lunch. It looks like we're still missing a few, but in keeping with our agenda, we will start the afternoon program. And it's probably just as well that it is not quite full, because as I mentioned to you before lunch, do not shoot the messenger. But what I did do was hire a bodyguard to deflect for me when I make the next announcement. That bodyguard is sitting to my immediate right, and his name is Dave Gardner. So he is prepared to shield me at all costs, okay? So with all of that, you can tell this is not gonna be good news. In terms of the high-speed internet access, you know, that's not very nice. I was trying to be nice and be helpful and do all of that stuff, but to laugh at me is just, you know, I want a crying towel instead. All right, here we go. In the latest memo sent on July the 7th, 2005 at 4:40 p.m. Eastern Standard Time from David Gardner to Carlene Randolph, who is CMS. This is the information about the internet, the wireless internet. And all of you also had access to this email. We were simply copied on it. It says, important, please remember that this is a, quote, paperless conference, end quote. You must download both day one and day two materials and bring them with you. How many did that? Yay, good job. If you prefer, the conference facility and hotel have a wireless network with access to the internet for a small fee. If you do not want to bring paper, there is no waiving of the high-speed internet access. Sorry. So it is $12.95 per 24 hours, noon to noon. You do have, if you are set up for wireless internet in this room, there is no charge. No, this room is not open 24 hours a day. You've all asked me these questions. I took a roll of toilet paper so that I could make a list of all the questions so that I would have long enough paper. But no, we do not have access. This room is open at about 7:30 in the morning, and we will close it at 6 o'clock at night. So if that's the way you're going to do it, otherwise you do not have it unless you pay for it outside of this room. And that is the last that we're going to say about the wireless internet. So, yay. All right, having said all of that, it is my pleasure to welcome back the presentation on interacting with the RDS Center using the BID Secure website. Our presenters are Pat Ambrose, David Gardner, and John Albert, and I'll turn it back to Pat. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlotte. Okay, we're going to get into, we're back to looking at PowerPoint slides and get into a discussion about your retiree files, the retiree lists that you must electronically submit to the RDS Center. Some general information: a qualifying covered retiree is considered eligible for the subsidy based on his or her Medicare entitlement. In other words, they must be entitled for Part A or Part B enrolled. And it's also necessary that they are not enrolled in Part D. The RDS Center is going to check that for you. So you would send your file of potential retirees that you wish to claim the subsidy on. We're going to take that file and check it against the Medicare Beneficiary Database, also known as MBD, in the CMS Data Center. And we will check periods of entitlement and periods of enrollment and make a determination for you about whether this retiree on your list is actually eligible for the subsidy. We will also check the major part of the Medicare Part D enrollment, as I'm sure you know, starts November 15th. And we will also check that information on MBD at that point in time. An application has to have at least one qualifying covered retiree in order to be approved. Only one file per application will be accepted. It's difficult for us to know if you have multiple files coming in for, now I'm talking about just for your initial submission or your monthly updates. Obviously, you're going to send us ongoing files on a regular basis, but I can't have them all coming from different places. I'll never know when to start processing. I'll never know when you have actually submitted your entire list of retirees for that particular file submission.
But that said, I mean, you could have a designee assigned to your application.
Absolutely.
Who could act on your behalf in aggregating that list for you from the various sources that you have to, with that information.
Absolutely. Yes, if your retiree list comes from different sources, it must be aggregated, rolled up into one file and sent to us in order for us to process it accurately. I talked a little earlier today about the unique benefit option identifier, and we suggest that being your prescription drug coverage group number. If you don't have one, again, you can create your own unique identifier for each under each application.
Just another point of clarification there. If you do have multiple applications because you have two different plans, for example, covered under two different applications, and if you're making up your unique benefit option identifiers, in other words, you're not using the RX group number, you have to be careful. The only thing that could potentially give us some difficulties is if you say, okay, I've got two benefit options under application A and they're numbered 1 and 2, and you also use number 1 and 2 over here potentially, you should try to use a unique benefit option identifier that is truly unique for any benefit option that you are introducing to the RDS Center.
Okay. The layouts for these files, we did receive a lot of questions about, you know, what are the file layouts, how do I create this file. Those instructions and the file layouts will be on the website Friday noon. They're ready to go. I need to get back to the office and get that information posted out for you in a controlled fashion. So you will be able to download that information Friday noon this week. Again, I mentioned before, but it's important to note that you must start your application before you can submit your retiree file, because the application ID is actually a field on each file record, as is the unique benefit option identifier. We talked also earlier about uploading to the RDS Secure website. I'm not going to actually demonstrate these screens today, but there will be a link on the secure website, the pages that I was showing you this morning, where you would then link to the file transfer facility. Initially, for our initial rollout of this file transfer, if you choose this option, you will need to re-authenticate. Same logon ID and password, but I'll need you to sign in again. It's actually a separate facility. It is at the RDS Center, but it's a separate facility, and we're working on integrating that, but bear with us. You'll also receive a pop-up that will ask you to validate your ability to see PHI and perform this process. So we're going to ask that you click and acknowledge the fact that PHI is involved in the process of uploading your file.
You had PHI, protected health information.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just in case someone doesn't know.
Okay. There will be, as you select this option on the website, your mailbox for the application will be created. So then as a user, when you log on to the file transfer facility, you'll be taken to a list screen of the mailboxes that you're able to access. Multiple users may access the same mailbox. You'll be able to download files more than once. So you will receive your response files back to this mailbox as well as upload through this facility as well. Oh, and I should mention that as we post the response file out there for you to pick up, you'll be notified via email. That would include the account manager, the authorized rep, and any other designees who have permission to do the file transfer. We also saw some questions about the file format for this HTTPS file transfer. It is a comma delimited file. I'll be showing you the actual data elements a little bit later. Mainframe to mainframe via the AGNIS network, the AT&T Global Services Network. Again, an RDS technician, an RDS center staff will contact your technical contact to talk about getting the connection up and running and doing some testing of that connectivity. It will use ConnectDirect over AGNIS. You will receive your response files this same way. If you choose whatever option you choose, that's how you're receiving your response files. So you will not go to the website and download your response file from the RDS center if you've chosen this mainframe to mainframe. You'll have to make sure that your technical contact who is handling this file transfer is able to provide you that response file after RDS has sent it back.
And that's one reason why it's so important to identify all the designees that you think might need to be involved at a later date with that data transfer, and the contact information for them must be accurate.
Right. And I guess I should also, this is not really related just to the mainframe to mainframe, but there is not an option on the secure website to type in your retiree list. You must send us a file by one of these three options. Likewise, it's not an option at this time to be able to view the response file, to scroll through all of your retirees and the responses that the RDS Center has generated. There will be an option for you to look up one retiree at a time as long as you have the identifying information for that person. But you really need to use these response files in order to determine what how the RDS Center has decided what the subsidy period will be for that particular, for each retiree. I'm now turning it over to John Elbert, who's going to give you some much desired information on the VDSA agreements.
It's okay if I stand up there?
Yeah.
Okay. I want to thank the RDS team for inviting me to come down here and say a few words about the voluntary data share agreement process. I love your beautiful bat cave. my name is John Elbert, and I work in CMS's Office of Financial Management, administering portions of the Medicare Coordination of Benefits contract. This is the one primary contractor that serves to provide the data that is used for payment authorization in paying claims. COB contract is about 5 years old, and one of the processes that it does, or some of the processes it is responsible for, is our coordination of benefits crossover agreements, voluntary data sharing agreements, which we're going to talk about, also the IRS SSA CMS data match project, which I'm sure a lot of employers at this audience are familiar with. The voluntary data share agreement process has been in existence now for about 5 years. We have approximately 84 participants, of which about 50 of them are large insurers, such as your Blue Cross Blue Shield plans, Aetna, Cigna, United Healthcare, et cetera, as well as 30-some Fortune 500, mostly Fortune 500 employers. These agreements are administered in an effort to speed up the coordination of benefits process. Unfortunately, people don't realize that CMS doesn't necessarily have the answers initially to make a correct payment determination, that we depend on all of the sources, other sources out there that are involved in claims payment, such as employers and insurers and providers and beneficiaries, to gather that information. But the problem with a lot of the processes that we have, in particular the IRS data match, is that because it relies on tax data to find out about individuals who are working, and then through a survey instrument we administer, whether or not they have group health plan coverage that may be primary to Medicare, by the time we get that data, it's very old. And what that means is that in the meantime, Medicare has made a lot of mistaken payments, which it then has to go back and recover. And I'm sure there's some people in here who have seen Medicare demand letters. They're very cumbersome for both CMS to administer as well as insurers and employers. So we started this voluntary data share agreement process, which essentially allows employers and insurers on their behalf to report quarterly information to us about their active covered individuals. And when I say active covered, this means these are working people who have group health plan coverage. But it also, on the flip side, it also provides tremendous benefits to the employer community as well, because they are just like us in that they don't always know what the other side has or what their beneficiaries have. They oftentimes offer retirement benefits to people that also have Medicare Parts A and B and soon will have Part D and have no idea about it and are paying, their plan is paying primary and Medicare is also paying primary. So this was a project to basically exchange data on a quarterly basis to improve coordination of benefits. Now with the implementation of the Part D benefit, MSP, the Medicare secondary payer rules for working covered individuals apply just like it does for the current Part A and B programs as well. In addition, CMS for the first time is actually going to be collecting and storing retiree coverage data so that it can better administer portions of the Part D benefit, which specifically relates to assisting the new Part D plans in getting them data to help them calculate the beneficiary's true out-of-pocket costs. Also, that data will be used to help facilitate proper billing at point of sale. Unlike the current Part A and B programs, it's not necessarily a real-time process, but with the new Part D benefit, it will be. So it's important for CMS to collect as much supplemental drug coverage data as possible so that the Part D plans can efficiently administer their programs. So to start off in terms of how the process works, there are three distinct processes within the voluntary data share agreement process. The first process, which we refer to as the MSP file, is essentially the employer and or insurer reports to CMS on a quarterly basis all those active covered individuals, including any covered spouses and dependents. The second process, which is the non-MSP file, there's three purposes for it. One of them is it allows a query of Medicare entitlement data. It also allows employers and insurers to report supplemental prescription drug coverage information. And thirdly, which you all are here for, is an option for employers to pass on subsidy enrollment files to the RDS contractor. So I'll go into a little bit of detail about each of these processes. The first process, the MSP file, this is where the employer essentially sends us a finder file of all of their active covered individuals and dependents and spouses, and Medicare compares, looks at its Medicare enrollment or MBD database to see if they have Medicare. Where there is Medicare, we build a MSP record so that if claims come in, that record will be there to note immediately that Medicare is the secondary payer to those employer group health plan benefits. The second process, which is the non-MSP file, again, this is actually is going to be either a monthly or a quarterly process. We wanted to make sure that we were running at the same pace with the RDS contractor, and we will be able to accept these files on a monthly basis or a quarterly basis. It's your option. But it basically, again, allows you to mine Medicare entitlement data. If you can report supplemental drug coverage information and also provide the RDS files through the VDSA process. Sorry, I didn't keep up with my slides. It's more on the VDSA to RDS process. Essentially, the VDSA process for subsidy purposes is merely acting as a face in that we will take the data in and pass it straight to the RDS contractor who will then do their magic work on it and pass the information back to us, and we will in turn pass it back to the submitter. The file processing will be available September 1st. We have draft agreements out for comment with people that we have current agreements with, as well as a pretty extensive list of leads of people who have contacted us directly seeking more information. Testing and signing and testing of the new agreements will begin August 1st. We will be able to basically meet all of the RDS timeframes for you to be able to pass data through the VDSA file layout to the RDS contractor by that September 30th deadline. You should note, though, that the entire new VDSA process will not actually go into production until November. But we, again, in the meantime, we'll be able to accept the subsidy files and pass them on to RDS within their time frames. Again, I mentioned that the VDSA is merely a face for the RDS operations, and that all of the other email alerts, et cetera, that you would normally expect to receive, whether or not you submitted directly to through their web portal or through a VDSA, you will get all of that information. The one thing, though, that the VDSA does with S records or subsidy records that are rejected by the RDS contractor, if the record is rejected by the RDS contractor because that particular individual is enrolled in Part D, we're actually going to capture that information as a supplemental drug reporting record so that we can assist the Part D plans in their troop facilitation as well as to assist the pharmacies with billing at point of sale. The other process that I wanted to mention is the Beneficiary Automated Status and Inquiry System. We just call it BASIS. This allows users to query Medicare entitlement using dial-up access to the COB contractor. These responses are usually available within 24 to 48 hours at a maximum. And I just wanted to mention that BASIS, while you do have the ability to query Medicare entitlement information, and in fact, all response records coming back, whether it's a subsidy record, a query record, a Part D reporting record, you're going to get basically all of this Medicare entitlement information, A, B, and D as well. But BASIS does serve to augment the electronic file exchange for when you have a more immediate need to know Medicare entitlement. For example, if you're an employer and you recently take on a new group and you want to find out now what their Medicare entitlement is versus waiting for the next file cycle, you can use BASIS to do that. The benefits of a VDSA, in summary, are quite extensive. They benefit both CMS and the employer, insurer, and beneficiary, community provider, et cetera, and that it's, you know, again, greatly speeds up the process. Again, by coordinating the benefits more timely, this results in better service to your Medicare-entitled EGHP subscribers. As employers, you no longer have to complete the annual IRS SSA CMS data match questionnaire. Employer expense associated with record retention and retrieval is reduced because instead of having to go back and mine old coverage data to report it on the data match, you're reporting to us on a current basis, so all of your coverage information should be online at the time. The quarterly or monthly exchange is easier to plan a budget for than the data match, which again is a yearly cycle. There is no fee whatsoever charged by CMS for this service. Fewer mistaken payments mean that the employer expense associated with recovery and dispute resolution is considerably reduced, and there are... Okay. Sorry. I just forgot to tape the slides. Sorry about that. You all are reading along. I'm trying to go fast because we're short on time, that's all. Okay. But anyway, fewer mistaken payments mean that the employer expense associated with the very expensive and time-consuming recovery process can be significantly reduced. There are actually, I've already met a few people that are our current VDSA partners who are in the audience who I think have taken tremendous advantage of this program to save their company, you know, immense amounts of money. I think that overall, you know, employers stand to benefit far more than CMS does, because no offense, but generally your data is not as good as ours on the front end. So again, we strongly encourage you to look into this program. And again, one of the biggest reasons to do it for you all is gaining access to that Medicare entitlement information so that you also know when to pay primary or secondary on your end as well. As I mentioned, CMS has a standard agreement that contains file layouts and descriptions of the data elements to be exchanged. One of the first questions is this HIPAA compliant? Yes, it is. Voluntary data sharing agreements, I mean, it may sound cliche, but they do represent a win-win situation for both employers, insurers, providers of healthcare services, and CMS, as well as our mutual customer, the beneficiary. And I guess on one final note I wanted to mention is that because the voluntary data share agreement process is fairly complicated, and just because the Medicare secondary payer rules are complicated, if employers decide that they cannot allocate resources to do one of these, we also encourage you to press your insurers to do one on your behalf. Again, we probably are capturing 50% of the MSP information that we receive through the insurers directly on behalf of the employers. The main thing is you need to talk to them and make sure they are updated so they can get, you know, accurate information to us. And I've included lots of contact information on the sheet for myself, Aaron Wesolowski, Bill Decker, who's also in the audience, as well as various websites and whatnot. We will have a lot more information out on the web this month. And again, contact us directly. We'll get you all of the file and record layouts and all of the other information that a lot of it works similar to the way, you know, some of the RDS processes work. So with that, I will conclude and say thank you. And I will be available up here at the next break if people want to ask questions or whatnot. So thank you. Sorry about the slides. Thank you.
I think I'll let Dave change my slides for me.
Yeah, just kick me.
No, I didn't want to hurt you or anything. Speaking of which.
All right, where are we? There we go. Whoop, hello.
There we go. So we're still talking about retiree files, and what I'm going to get into now is the initial submission. So when you're submitting your application, one of the requirements is that you submit the entire list of retirees along with your application. Subsequent to that, there'll be monthly updates. So this initial submission should include all retirees to be covered by the subsidy during the plan sponsor's plan year. For those plan years ending in 2006, as you know, the retiree list must be received by the RDS Center by September 30th. For subsequent plan years, just as, you know, follows the same rules as the filing limit for your application, 90 days prior to the start of the plan year. Subsequent monthly submissions. We are looking for you to supply, as things change or you learn more information about your retirees, or as new retirees come on or drop off of your plan, you should report that to the RDS Center on a regular basis. As John said, VDSA, while originally we were providing instruction that VDSA would only be a quarterly process, it is also monthly. You may participate in VDSA and submit your retiree files for RDS processing on a monthly basis. So this file should include the any ad records. There'll be a record indicator to state whether you're submitting an ad, an update to someone that you've already submitted previously, or a deletion of someone that you might have sent accidentally. There's a difference between terminating a subsidy period as opposed to deleting. A deletion is you accidentally sent this record and did not intend to, and you need to delete that. This person is not participating in your plan, for example, and it was or a plan covered by an approved application. A termination, on the other hand, is if one of your retirees then drops out of your plan, you would send a record with an end date in that the coverage end date, and that way we would be able to terminate the subsidy period that we have on our records.
Right, and that would be an update record.
Correct.
Not a termination record,
correct.
An update record with a term date added.
Correct. So you use the delete transaction when you want to remove that retiree entirely from your application, and then, as Dave said, the update to change that end date or to terminate them. We're not accepting full file replacements at this time. There's various reasons, as you know, the technicians in the audience know that, you know, in some cases it might be easier for you to code. However, it does complicate things for the RDS Center. We had to go one way or the other, and our interpretation of the regulation was that the monthly files would be updates as opposed to full file replacements. We believe this is a better solution. It's really the way that CMS is going with these data exchanges. VDSA operates in the same fashion. So we're trying to be consistent, you know, with other processes and the trends. It obviously controls the amount of volume of data that's exchanged back and forth, and space. You need to retain your retiree files that you send to RDS for a significant period of time. So if you're sending full file replacements, it could be a considerable space issue for you. And of course, there's the processing time. If you're sending just the adds, deletes, and updates, we're able to get through that file and send a response back to you in a more timely fashion. Note that you must process the response files that we send back. We may, and I'll talk a little bit more about this, but we may change, not change the dates, but we're going to give you information back upon about the dates that you may actually claim the subsidy. So a start and end date for how, for those months that you may claim the subsidy for that particular, for each retiree. And it's important for you then to take that response file and actually process it. So if you're getting responses back, full file every time, again, you know, an increase in processing time on both sides. We will notify you, and I'll talk a little bit more about the notifications. We'll notify you about a change of information. I mentioned before that RDS is going to be checking the Medicare beneficiary database on entitlement and enrollment information. If we get a change of information, we will notify you so that you can resubmit records accordingly, or we may just notify you of a change that we've made internally and you need to apply to your system.
And those changes could be many different things. I mean, one of the largest reasons could be for a Part D enrollment, and we're going to be matching, or not matching, but we'll be sharing or getting alert files or updates from our Part D enrollment transaction processing system. And sharing that information with you, I believe, on a daily basis?
Yes.
Actually,
on a weekly basis.
Okay, sorry, a weekly basis. But periodically, you'll need to go out and check your account because these files will be out there. It's our way of communicating to you what these changes are and how it might affect the various qualifying covered retirees that you are claiming for subsidy. Another example of an alert type of notification would be if there was some change to the Medicare beneficiary database that is ultimately fed to the RDS center, such as a date of death that we receive from Social Security, or a change in the actual Medicare Part A entitlement, effective and termination dates on the database, or Part B enrollment, and start and end date, effective and term date. So did I steal your thunder?
No,
next slide?
That's okay.
Sorry.
Just less for me to say later.
Sorry.
on the next slide, I actually have listed here the submitted data elements. I did try to include the file layouts in this presentation. It was just too messy. So like I said, you'll see those on the website on Friday. I've mentioned several times that the application ID number must be, this is basically a record layout or the fields per retiree that you must submit. You must submit either the Social Security number or the HIC number for a retiree. You can submit both. The first name, middle initial is optional, last name. All of these fields, by the way, are required unless otherwise indicated here. Date of birth, gender, the coverage effective date, and coverage termination date. I presume most times the coverage effective date on the file that you transmit to us will be the beginning of your plan year, but it should reflect the actual date that your retirees were enrolled in the plan that is covered by your application, of course. And you may leave the coverage termination date blank. We will assume that if you have done that, that it's the end date of your plan year. Again, when you're sending in an update record to terminate, to tell us about terminating coverage for a particular retiree, you'd send in the update record with the coverage termination date completed. Here's that unique benefit option identifier that we have spoken about earlier. That's required on this record. We need to associate the retirees with the benefit option under your application, more for our payment process later on down the road, but this is an important correlation for us for later processing. You need to include an indication of the relationship to the retiree. There'll be on the file layout, the values for these fields are posted and the exact formats and that sort of thing are there. and then the action type of the record, add, delete, or update. The response file that we send back to you for your retiree list will be everything that you sent to us, exactly as you sent it to us. If you sent us the Social Security number, we're not sending you back the HIC number. And then we will add on to the end of the record, after the action type, we will add on information derived by the RDS Center. So it's all those same fields that you sent to us, plus an indication. The subsidy approval indicator is a yes or no, whether this retiree was, whether you can claim this retiree for the subsidy under the application in question. Then we'll provide you with reason codes. These reason codes could be errors that are present on this particular record, an invalid date or something like that. We will make use of the reason codes also for the notifications, which I'll talk about later. Then we are going to provide you subsidy effective and termination dates. Basically, after we've gone to MBD and determined Medicare eligibility, it may not coincide exactly with the beginning of your plan year. Obviously, for plan years that have already started and are overlapping into 2006, your subsidy period will not be prior to January 1, 2006. So there's several factors that go into RDS setting these dates. It's also important to note that you may receive multiple response records back for one retiree. It gets kind of complicated. Some Medicare beneficiaries have breaks in their entitlement, which would cause a scenario perhaps where you would be able to claim the subsidy for 3 months for an individual. Perhaps the next 3 months you would not be able to, and then there would be a subsequent period through the end of your plan year where you would. So you need to expect to receive back, in some exceptional cases, multiple responses for each retiree. And the reason for these multiple responses, again, will be separate periods of coverage, in a sense, what I'm referring to as the subsidy periods, when you can actually claim those costs for reimbursement from the RDS Center.
Another important distinction to make here between the file that the RDS Center can send back to plan sponsors versus what the Coordination of Benefits Contractor sends back. The RDS Center is sending back the information that you see on this slide, whereas the VDSA process gives a more robust data set back. You get the actual Medicare Part A effective and term dates and Part B enrollment dates as well. And so that's a big pro for going the VDSA route. You get the granular level data that CMS has access to. And the reason why we don't provide that information under the RDS, from the RDS Center directly through the website, if you don't have a VDSA, is because we are only allowed to share information with you to the extent we need it to manage the program. So we have to give you back the minimum amount of data for privacy reasons that you need and we need in order to pay the subsidy correctly. Again, if you go VDSA route, you get as much data as we have to offer. Is there anything else that we should add?
No, the only thing I wanted to add about it's something that we've seen on our end a lot, and that is, Pat was talking about the multiple records coming back. Despite your best efforts, you're going to have a lot of people who enroll in Part D and then disenroll. So I would expect to see probably quite a few of, and a lot of, and right now, I mean, most people that have Part B don't necessarily need it yet. A lot of them enroll in it anyway, even though they already have good coverage through their work, but even though, and they have to pay a premium to do so. But Part B enrollment is much higher than it needs to be for the beneficiary. But just out of a fear of the unknown, we expect there to be a lot of people that enroll in Part D that don't have to, just like they do with Part B right now. So I would expect, I would say that do as much as you can in terms of outreach to keep those beneficiaries from enrolling in Part D. Again, that's why you will see, in the future at least, quite a few split records coming back.
Okay, so, thank you. Mm-hmm. Both very, very good points. My next slide was on the subsidy periods. I think I've covered most of this information about the multiple responses and the reason for that. Notifications. We're going to use the same response file layout just to make it simple as possible. And we will make use of the reason code field to let you know what this notification is about. We may be also changing the subsidy effective and termination date as well, so you'll get that type of information back. And all of these notifications, all the response files that the RDS Center creates for you, you will receive an email, and again, it would be the authorized rep, the account manager, and other designees involved in the file transfer process. They would receive an email to let you know that the file has been sent, and that's no matter whether we're putting it on the website for you to download, or it's mainframe to mainframe, or it's VDSA. So you, and these notifications will come out through the VDSA process too, which is a slightly new process under VDSA to have an unsolicited notification record coming back to you.
Now, are we going to be sending email notifications when we receive the file, just to let folks know? Or I'm not sure if
it's not in the current plan.
Okay,
no.
So.
Here he goes, changing my requirements again.
Sorry. We'll work on that.
Yeah. Next release, okay.
Where's my hard hat?
Really? okay. So some of the reasons for the notifications. We are posting these subsidy periods on the MBD file, on the MBD database, the Medicare Beneficiary Database. So we're interacting, the RDS Center is interacting with other CMS Medicare systems to notify and make this information available for other system processing. So the subsidy, once we have accepted someone into the subsidy program or a retiree into the subsidy program, that information will be available on their Medicare beneficiary database record, which means that starting in November 15th, when Medicare beneficiaries attempt to enroll in Part D, initially, if they are already claimed during that same period by a plan sponsor for the subsidy program, their initial enrollment application will be rejected with an explanation, obviously. And we will be notified by that system that is performing the or approving the enrollment process. We'll be notified at the RDS Center that they've rejected one of your retirees for Part D. We're going to provide that information to you on this notification file so that you know that some of your retirees may be trying to sign up for Part D, and you can intervene, perform some outreach, and explain to them that they have coverage that's equivalent or better than the Medicare prescription drug coverage, so you know they really don't need to pay the premium and sign up for Part D. On the other hand, it's possible that your retiree, the beneficiary overrides that decision. They are allowed to say, I still want Part D coverage. In that case, we will be notified by these internal CMS systems, and we will terminate the subsidy period accordingly. If it's the entire time, then you know obviously we're essentially not really deleting the record, but terminating it on the same date that it started. And most likely, though, it's subsequent to when their subsidy period actually started. We will notify you and of that information with updated subsidy coverage effective and termination dates so that you know exactly what's happened. And you'll know also the reason for that is that your retiree has signed up for Part D and you can no longer claim them for the subsidy.
And just to add a little bit to what Pat said, if we are getting these alerts, again, on a daily basis sent to us from that Part D enrollment transaction system. And it's conceivable that if a retiree or Medicare beneficiary decides late in the month that they do want to sign up for Medicare Part D, it initially gets rejected, it goes back, and then the beneficiary decides to override that and says, yes, no, I do want Medicare Part D, I'm sure of it. When that comes back through, that second notification we send back out to you, it's conceivable that there could only be a couple days notice before that Part D enrollment would actually become effective. But rest assured, as soon as we get the notice, which is at most a 24-hour time lag, that will be posted to your plan sponsor account online. So There are going to be instances where those late month enrollments leave just a couple of days for any outreach to be conducted.
Okay. This process for notifications won't start until November 1st. The other systems that we're interfacing with actually won't be ready to provide this information, and as we mentioned before, the push for Part D enrollment really starts November 15th. So you shouldn't expect to receive a lot of these notifications regarding your retirees' attempts to enroll in Part D until after November 15th. Our goal is to get accurate subsidy periods posted on the Medicare beneficiary database prior to November 15th so that we can have a smooth process here. There's another case where you may be notified of a change. Every now and then there are corrections on the Medicare beneficiary database to entitlement or eligibility information. Dave mentioned before that a beneficiary may pass away. So you will receive notifications about changes. In the event that we have a subsidy period posted on the RDS Center's database for you, and we get information then from the Medicare beneficiary database saying that entitlement has changed, if that causes us to either terminate or shorten the subsidy period, we will go ahead and do so and send you this notification with the changed dates. On the other hand, if you had sent us information about someone who we came back and said that they are not actually eligible for the subsidy, and then we find out that possibly they are because of a change or correction to information, we will send you an alert or a notification that will basically say, this retiree, you need to resubmit, or you may want to consider resubmitting. The reason that we don't add a subsidy period for you is that we won't know for sure whether they're still covered by your plan or not. So we are going to notify you of changes of information, and I hope that alleviates some of the concern over the full file replacement issue that we were talking about earlier.
Yes, our goal is to absolutely provide you the best and most accurate information that we have so that you can proceed to make payment requests in an accurate way.
I listed here a whole bunch of reason codes that you will get back initially on your retiree file list. We are adding to this list for the notifications, and we'll provide that additional information for you. But pretty much it's your standard checks in terms of the file that for various an invalid application ID, we couldn't match it up, or some required field was not in the proper format, something along those lines. I wanted to go over what we've done so far today is talked about the application process practically from start to finish. And so now you've submitted, I should make Dave put the crown on again, but we've put that away. And but I wanted to go through then what the RDS Center is going to do to validate your application. A lot of validation happens online real time in terms of the fields that you're entering, the data that you're entering, is it a valid date, and so on. But then after you've submitted your application, these are some of the things that are that we'll be looking at. I mean, obviously, we will have already, before you're allowed to submit your application, validated that the plan sponsor is a valid entity. And at least, as I mentioned, you need to have at least one qualifying covered retiree on your retiree list. We will be validating your bank account. I mentioned before that we're doing an EFT pre-note process to make sure that we can communicate between RDS and your bank. We'll also be checking certain debarment lists and exclusion lists for entities or persons who may be on this list as having committed fraud in the past or been debarred that from conducting business with the government. So actually all users who are involved in your application process will be checked through this process, as well as the plan sponsor entity itself. I do want to note that because of potential problems with typographical errors or something like that, we will allow you to change your electronic fund information once, so your application won't actually be rejected the first time if we fail on the pre-note process, but rather we'll work with you to resubmit that information another time and try again. After the second time, we start to get kind of suspicious and are not going to actually let you change it again. In addition to those things, your actuary must obviously be a member of the American Academy of Actuaries, and you must have met your timely filing requirements or have requested an extension. The last thing that I'd like to cover briefly are some other features on the website. I didn't show you everything. I'm not going to hassle with bringing the screens back up. If we have to later in the Q&A session, we could possibly do that. But some of the other functions that will be available is viewing your retiree status. As I mentioned before, this will be a one retiree at a time inquiry rather than scrolling through a long list of retiree statuses. In order to see the entire list, you need to, again, access your the response file that we send back. I showed earlier where on that application list screen for your plan sponsor, where you would see the request for, and it had the actions on the side where you would see the request for an extension. You would basically select that from a drop-down box and go from there. That's also the same location where you would withdraw an application that's been submitted and you've had a change of heart and actually need to reconsider that application and you want the RDS Center to stop its consideration. You can delete an application, but only if you have not submitted it. You will not be able to delete a submitted application, whether it's approved or rejected, for that matter.
Yeah, and I'm not sure we made the point earlier today, but as you're working on your application online, you can save it in its status
as
you leave the website. So you haven't submitted it yet, but you can save it, come back later, and to complete the application.
Yeah, we are going to request that you, as you're filling out page by page of your application or section by section, that you're submitting valid data. You'll have error messages as you go along. If you're not ready to submit that page, you can cancel out of it and the data won't be saved. But if you're clicking on the continue button like I was earlier today, that data is saved on our database page by page so that you can complete two pages out of the total and then come back the next day and finish the rest of it. So that is a good point. Let's see, where are we? You can submit an appeal on a rejected application from that plan sponsor application list screen. There'll also be functionality to appeal a particular retiree denial if you actually believe that that retiree is indeed eligible to be claimed for the subsidy. You'll be able to view online your appeal status. There's various levels that the appeal may take to, or reconsideration is probably a better word for this process, and that status of that information will be available. I do want to talk a little bit more about the appeal process. Tomorrow, Patricia Pergal is going to come up and talk about appeals, and there's a slide in there that I was going to show some HTML or show you the actual screens, but we decided it would get kind of awkward to have people jumping up and down. So the appeal process will work like this. You will go to that plan sponsor application list screen, as I had showed you earlier. You will select an appeal action. A screen will appear for you to enter your reason or rationale for the appeal, why you believe that your application should be reconsidered, and you'll submit that to the RDS Center. That's it. Now, you cannot attach any files for your appeal to the RDS Secure website at this point in time. If you need to send supporting information, there'll be a PO box that is posted on the website, so you could actually mail in that information, or you could fax it in, and the RDS Center staff would take that, scan it, and attach it to your appeal request, and we would be storing that information and taking it into consideration for your appeal request.
Right. Any individual involved with reviewing those materials from RDS Center staff at the reconsideration level or CMS hearing officer or administrator review level, those individuals would be able to view all documents associated with your appeal request via the secure website. So in that regard, we are paperless on our side, but we are allowing you to send paper to us in those circumstances where you feel you need to do so.
We've received several questions about this change of information related to your application or your personal information. I showed you this morning where you're able to select certain features. There are certain links on the website for you to update your personal information. You'll be able to update your plan sponsor information, reassign your authorized rep, or reassign an account manager. Changing the plan sponsor information, reassigning the authorized representative, and reassigning the account manager are all done from the same link on the website. It will say manage your plan sponsor account, so it'll be fairly intuitive to step you through that. There is some information that you may change that that will not cause us to need to revalidate your application or your plan sponsor account. On the other hand, there may be information that you need to change, and it's a different process that will take place where actually, if you need to change the something about the actuarial attestation for your benefit options and regroup them or something along those lines, that's going to require us to revalidate, obviously, the application itself. On the other hand, if you'd like to go in and change your retiree file submission method, you can do that without us having to reconsider your application all over again. So you could start out in September submitting your retiree file via the upload to the secure website and be working with John on a VDSA, on a voluntary data sharing agreement. And at the point that you know you are ready to submit your retiree files and updated files through the VDSA process, at that point in time, you can go in and change your option for transmitting your retiree files to the RDS Center, and we'll expect to then get your file via the VDSA process instead, and of course, we'll be sending your responses back that way. So there is a timing issue there as well to expect. Basically, the way that you send the file in is the way that we're going to respond back. So just make sure that you're prepared for that and that you update, your update on the website is timed appropriately. You'll also be able to reassign an actuary or a designee on your application. You can go in and essentially expire a designee or an actuary on your application and say this person is no longer able to work on my applications or on my account. And I did show you the contact us feature where you could ask questions about your specific application. I think that's all I have.
Very good.
Yep.
I think we're set.
Thank you to Pat, Dave, and John for their information on interacting with the CDS Center using the RDS Secure website. We're going to make a slight change in the schedule. We're going to go ahead and do the RDS Customer Services overview and then take our break, because after that break, then we will be set up for the panel Q&A session. So I'd like to thank our panel here and ask Carol and Frank to come on up. Thank you very much. you run a little short. I'm expecting you to go long.
We probably will.
You all ready? Our next presentation is RDS Customer Services Overview. We have two presenters, Carol Gilbo and Frank Davies. Carol is the RDS Assistant Program Director, Government Programs, Group Health Incorporated. She has over 30 years' experience in the healthcare industry as a director of large staffs and administrative processes that lead to effective solutions and resolution of customer inquiries, concerns, and complaints. Carol and her staff administer the Retiree Drug Subsidy Customer Service Department that provides support for the employer plan sponsor community as well as the application auditing department. Prior to joining the RDS team, Carol was the director of the GHI Medicare government programs for the Coordination of Benefits Contract, which is a centralized operation that performs all activities that support the collection, management, and reporting of other insurance coverage of Medicare beneficiaries. Responsibilities include the COB National Call Center, auditing, and EDI departments. Carol was the director of GHI's medical claims operation from 1995 to 2004, responsible for processing over 7 million paper claims per year. Prior to joining GHI, Carol worked at Equitable Life Assurance Society for over 20 years. Carol assisted in the development of their first online claim system, managed the insurance contract, and implemented and directed a third-party agreement. Frank Davies is the Retiree Drug Subsidy Trainer, Government Programs, Group Health Incorporated. Frank has served as RDS trainer for the RDS Center since May 2005. He has worked extensively in the implementation of the RDS call center, as well as the design and implementation of the RDS Center Training Program. Frank recently presented on the National RDS Conference call regarding the customer service functions of the RDS Center. He has over 15 years insurance industry experience and over 10 years experience in the health insurance industry. Additionally, Frank has worked as a trainer for over 6 years, specializing in customer services delivery for health insurance organizations. Prior to joining the RDS Center, Frank served as training manager for two major New York Union employee benefit funds. His insurance exposure is extensive, and he has worked with many different insurance products, including Medicare plans. Frank was awarded with the Commitment to Excellence Award for exceptional effort for his work implementing a customer service call center unit in 2000. It is my pleasure to welcome Carol and Frank.
Thank you, Charlotte. Good afternoon, everyone. It is a pleasure to be here today in Dallas, Texas. And I really realized today after hearing my bio, I have to change it. 30 years, wow, I'm not that old, really. I started very, very young. Okay. Just wanted to clear that up. Joining me today is Frank Davies. As you heard, Frank is the trainer for the RDS Center. We are happy to be here today to talk to you about customer service functions of the RDS Center and what the RDS Center can do for you. All of the services offered through the RDS Center was designed with one thought in mind, you. The RDS Center has one goal, to provide you with the most up-to-date information you need about the RDS program and the application process.
Afternoon, everybody. I like to say I'm very happy to be up here with Carol to talk to you about the customer service function. But before we begin, I just want to tell you for the past week, I have had this recurring nightmare about tripping up the stairs coming up to do my presentation. So I'm glad I made it up here in one piece. Before we begin, how many times has this happened to you? Thank you for holding. To hear classical music, press 1. To hear jazz music, press 2. To hear blues, press 3. For country music, press 4. And press 5 if you are a person who could stand complete silence. Ever call somewhere looking for help and feel like all you did was sit on the phone and listen to music? I'm sure at one time or another, we have all felt what this customer is feeling right now: frustration, annoyance, anger. We are here today to tell you that customers of the RDS Center will not experience any of those things.
What will you receive from the RDS Center? Service, of course, but most important, information, attention, the kind of service that was once the norm now seems to be like a legend from a long time ago. As you can see on the screen, these are the actual faces of the RDS Customer Service Center. Caring individuals there to assist you. Information you need when you need it. This is the mission of the RDS Center. We are committed to customer satisfaction. Our goal is to provide each of our customers with the finest service possible. Over the next several minutes, we will take you on a journey through the RDS Center and what it can do for you.
The purpose of this helpline is to provide general information regarding the RDS program. A limited number of customer service representatives are available to answer your questions. For the most detailed and up-to-date information about the program, please visit our website at rds.cms.hhs.gov.
Those of you who have already had the opportunity to call us are very familiar with that voice. There are two valuable tools that you have access to as an RDS customer: the RDS public website and the RDS helpline. Both can provide you with information about the RDS program. During our journey, we will explore each of these options and how they can meet your needs. First, let's take a look at the RDS public website. The RDS public website went live on June 1st of this year. Since going live, over 22,000 visitors have accessed the RDS homepage. Why so many visits? The reason is simple. The RDS public website was designed to serve as the primary source of information about the RDS program. By accessing the website, you are just a few clicks away from the information you need. The public website can provide you with general RDS program information, general application processing information, the ability to submit feedback or questions to the RDS Center, and information about RDS events, as well as the ability to register for those events, such as the conference you are attending today and tomorrow. Please visit the website often to find out more information about upcoming events. The RDS public website is fast, simple, and secure, and offers you a one-stop shop for RDS information. You will also have the ability to subscribe for e-news bulletins. This is a valuable tool, as you will automatically receive email updates regarding RDS program developments. You will also be able to obtain general information about the payment process in the coming months. The website also contains links to the CMS website. The CMS website is another important resource available to you that provides additional information about the Medicare Modernization Act as well as the RDS program. There will also be fact sheets available on the RDS website in the coming months. Some of the topics these fact sheets will cover include using VDSA from start to finish, the interim payment request process, the reconciliation process, the payment process, appeals, and how to set up your account, just to name a few. Beginning August 1st, the homepage of the RDS website will look a bit different than it does today. In addition to the information and services that are currently available, the RDS homepage will offer you the ability to log on to the secure website you learned about earlier today. This will be the starting point for setting up your user ID, as well as establishing those two important security questions, which the RDS Center will use to validate your identity when you call inquiring about an application. All of the information you need in one place. Just another example of how the RDS Center has your convenience in mind. The RDS website is meant to serve as the prime source of information for the RDS program. But there may be times when you visit our website and do not find the answer to a specific question you have about the program. Another service the website offers is the visitors will have the ability to submit questions via the website. Just another example of the one-stop shopping the RDS website offers. The RDS Center strives to deliver the best service possible. That is why it is our goal to answer all questions submitted through the website within 48 hours. You may also have specific questions about the laws and regulations that govern the RDS program, or the guidance papers issued by CMS regarding the program. Information about these topics can be found on the CMS website employer page. The CMS employer page provides a listing of frequently asked questions you can use as a resource. If your question is not addressed, you can submit it via the feedback option available on the CMS website. You can access the CMS employer page by visiting the web address found in your materials today. I would now like to turn the presentation over to Carol, who will talk to you about the RDS helpline. Carol?
Thank you, Frank. The RDS helpline was designed to complement the services available on the website. On June 16th of this year, the RDS Center helpline went live. The first call to the RDS Center was at exactly 8 a.m. That is totally true, and I thought it was Dave Gardner calling saying, is the line up and running? Actually, it was a caller that had attended the national conference call the day before and wanted information about the conference today. So maybe if you're in the audience, you can raise your hand and let me know if you were the first caller. Okay. I can't see anyway, so I don't know. Well, this was an exciting moment for the RDS Center. At the conclusion of the call, I have to tell you, everyone cheered. We clapped, we were so excited. We were in the office at 6:30 that morning making sure everything was ready to go. And after many months of preparation, it was exciting to put the wheels in motion, I have to tell you. The helpline offers you two options. The interactive voice response system, and live customer support. During the next part of our journey, we will take a closer look at these two services. What does the RDS helpline have to offer? You can reach our IVR 24 hours per day, 7 days per week. Live customer service support is available from 8 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Each of these options offer you information in both English and Spanish. Hearing impaired customers can also access the RDS helpline via our TTY capabilities. Let's start with the basics. What is an interactive voice response system? An interactive voice response system is a multimedia self-service tool that automates an interaction traditionally conducted by contact center agents. What advantages does the IVR have for you? Using the IVR provides you with choices on how and when you want your information. You can choose to utilize the IVR to obtain information you need by navigating through a series of pre-recorded information about the RDS program. Some of the topics the IVR can provide information on is an overview of the RDS program, information about upcoming RDS events, application submission information, and general payment information. The best part of all, the IVR is available 24 hours per day, 7 days a week, so information can be obtained whenever you want. And I know we work all kinds of crazy hours, so I believe that is a great advantage. In addition to the website and the IVR, we do have a limited number of highly trained representatives that are available to assist you. Representatives can provide you with information about the program, upcoming RDS events, and answer specific questions that cannot be located on our website or through the IVR. Service representatives can answer questions about the various roles of the individuals completing the application, retiree list submission deadlines, and application process, just to name a few. The RDS customer service representatives have your security in mind, as Pat has talked about today. When you call, we will have to ask you to authenticate your identity if you're calling regarding a specific question to your application. If you're calling, and we're going to answer your two security questions, so you have to remember them. But if you're just calling regarding general information, that would not be necessary. We will just answer your questions. Okay, most importantly, I guess everyone wants to know, what is our phone number? Our phone number is 1-877-RDS-HELP, H-E-L-P, or 877-737-4357. We like the word help. We all need our help with the application, I'm sure. And hearing impaired customers can also access the RDS helpline via TTY capabilities at 877-RDS-TTY-0 or 877-737-8890. Additionally, you can always contact the RDS Center by sending us an email via our website at rds.cms.hhs.gov under the contact option. Earlier in our journey, we talked about the level of service you can expect from the RDS Center. The question you may now have now is, how are we going to keep our promise to you? There are two important programs in the RDS Center that are very, very hard to put together in a short period of time. It is our training program and our quality assurance program.
So what is the goal of the RDS training program? To ensure the highest level of service possible through continued training and coaching. It is the belief of the RDS Center that only through continued training, education, and coaching that excellence can be achieved. That is why the training program will continue to expand as the RDS program evolves. Ensuring that you always receive the most accurate and up-to-date information from the RDS Center staff.
And on quality assurance, we want to ensure you that...
Welcome to the Retiree Drug Subsidy Helpline. Sorry. For quality assurance purposes, this call may be monitored and or recorded.
We just wanted to remind you we were recording the calls.
For quality assurance. Okay. The goal of the quality assurance program is continually to improve customer service satisfaction through delivery of high quality customer service. Through a continuous process of assessment and feedback, the RDS Center ensures that each of your interactions with us is of the highest quality possible. As a result, 100% of all our incoming calls will be recorded and reviewed. Now, as an additional bonus, because before we enter a presentation, Frank would like to provide you with an inside tip about the RDS Center just for you attending today's conference.
The RDS Center always gives 100% effort to customer service because it is all about you. We give 12% on Monday. Hey, we're just getting back from the weekend, people. 23% on Tuesday. Things are looking a little better. 40% on Wednesday. That's a banner day. 20% on Thursday. And, well, only 5% on Friday. Hey, it's the end of the week. We're planning our weekend. Clearly, based on those percentages, the best day to call us is Wednesday. But seriously, the RDS Center is always committed to 100% satisfaction of your needs. Whether you access us by telephone or electronically, the RDS Center will always work to provide you with the best service possible.
Frank and I would like to thank you for joining us on our journey through the RDS Center. We look forward to assisting you in the future. Frank and I will be here throughout the conference. Should you have any questions, please feel free to speak with us. Thank you very much.
Carol and Frank, thank you. I have some good news for you as well. It's really good news. Exceptionally good news. Yay. Because you were so nice, and Frank and Carol were exceptionally nice of slipping in so that we could take a break and set up for the panel. Originally, you were going to have a 20-minute break. Well, because I'm trying to get back on your good side, we are going to take a 30-minute break and reconvene here at 3:15. Is that nice? Yes. All right. See you at 3:15. Thank you.